the William A. Bug Bridge. When it first opened in 1961, this was one of only three permanent floating bridges in the world, and it was an immediate hit with the locals.
It's the only link for people who want to get from Jefferson or Clallam County over to this side into Seattle, which is, of course, the biggest city in the area.
Although officially named the William A. Bug, this bridge is better known for the piece of water it spans, the Hood Canal.
The name is misleading. Hood Canal isn't actually a canal. It's a fjord, a narrow, deep valley cut by a glacier and then flooded by the ocean. It's about a mile and a half or 2.4 kilometers across, but a massive 50 miles or 80 kilometers long.
At the time, nearby Seattle was home to the world's longest floating bridge, successfully spanning Lake Washington. But crossing the Hood Canal was a whole new challenge.
The fjord is 347 feet, or more than 100 meters deep. That's far too deep to build a bridge with legs. At that length, they would need to be impossibly wide to be strong and stable enough. And building a suspension bridge would be astronomically expensive. And so a floating bridge is what made the most sense.
The bridge would be supported by a series of 23 concrete pontoons, held in place with cables and anchors on the seabed. Although made of concrete, the pontoons float because they're hollow like a barge. The bridge deck sits above on elevated trusses. It may sound like a simple idea, but it was hugely ambitious, as state bridge engineer Patrick Clark explains.
The canal at that time was unusual, and it was the only floating bridge that had an elevated roadway all the way across. And the reason for that, the waves are much bigger on Hood Canal than they are on Lake Washington. So with the high elevated structure, traffic's able to travel along with wave spray basically passing underneath.
And it needed its elevated status because despite being deceptively calm, on some days this fjord can be anything but, as winds roll in from the nearby Olympic Mountains.
Although a long, narrow fjord might seem like the perfect sheltered harbor, in certain conditions, the Hood Canal is almost the opposite. It acts like a giant wind tunnel, focusing high winds along the valley, which whip the ocean up, creating huge waves, and the Hood Canal Bridge lies right across their path.
As well as withstanding these unpredictable conditions, this floating bridge had to be engineered for another purpose.
The US Navy has had a base on the Hood Canal since the Second World War. It's now used by the Pacific Submarine Fleet. So when the bridge was built, for reasons of national security, it had to be able to open wide.
While most opening bridges lift or swing, this one retracts or withdraws, referred to as a draw span. The design incorporates two floating sections in the center of the bridge that can be withdrawn back towards each shore. When fully retracted, a 180 meter gap in the middle allows large naval vessels to pass.
The draw span is a great solution for letting marine traffic through. But in an area of high winds, strong tides and currents, you're left with two very long floating jetties, each of them much more vulnerable to sideways forces than if they were permanently connected.
For 17 years, the bridge battled Mother Nature and slashed journey times across the Hood Canal. But an unexpected weakness was about to be dramatically exposed. On February 13, 1979, a storm rolled from the Pacific Ocean into Washington's Hood Canal.
I think that this was a once-in-a-lifetime windstorm for this area. I don't remember any nearly as severe as that. And the sky was quite dark, and there were big white caps all over the canal, and the trees were waving like crazy, whishing wind through.
To protect the bridge, the draw span was opened.
And when you build these big, heavy draw spans, they draw a lot more load. But when the storms start to come up, we shut it down to traffic and we retract the draw span back onto each side, so we leave a 600-foot opening. It relieves the pressure from the wind and waves on the bridge.
Experts calculated that hurricane-force winds were blowing up the fjord, exceeding 120 miles, or nearly 200 kilometers an hour. There was also a strong current flowing in the opposite direction. Working together, they battered the bridge.
The pounding appeared to be more than the bridge could handle.
I had a friend who lived near here. She called me and said, "Norma, can you see the bridge?" And I said, "Yes." She said, "It's going down." So I walked over to my big window and looked out. It was, it just rolled over.
At around 7:30 a.m., the floating bridge broke free from its anchors, rolled over, and sank.
It went, you know, it was really a few seconds, but we could really see it.
The bridge was at the bottom of the fjord. The crossing had been closed before the storm hit, so luckily no one was hurt. But in a region known for its extreme weather, why had the bridge failed so catastrophically?
With nearly half of the bridge's 23 pontoons sunk, residents and officials were left asking, how did this happen?
Investigations revealed that the perfect storm, both in terms of weather and engineering failures, had hit the bridge.
So when the storm came on, they had much more significant wind and wave forces on here, and then you had the tide going against the wind, caused the seas to stack. And it started to drag these anchors. And when you start to drag these anchors, the bridge starts to go out of alignment and it loses its support.
At this point, another part of the bridge became a problem. The walls on the sides of the maintenance deck.
On the top deck, there was these barriers added on there for safety of the workers. Well, it wasn't anticipated that the water would come on so rapidly that the water couldn't drain through the drains fast enough and it actually filled between the barriers.
All that trapped water began to find its way through the maintenance hatches.
These hatches were larger hatches that really weren't designed for real high pressures because it wasn't anticipated.
The pressure burst the hatches, allowing water to flood into the pontoons.
You get more water in your pontoons, you start to lose flotation, you get top heavy, you lose your transverse support, and the bridge started developing cracks, and then so it's again, it's a progressive failure.
The final straw in this epic fail came when the cables connecting the pontoons to their underwater anchors finally snapped. The Hood Canal Bridge may have been underwater, but leaving local communities cut off wasn't an option. A new bridge had to be built, and this time it had to be able to survive whatever Mother Nature could throw at it. State engineer Patrick Clark helped rebuild the bridge.
We're confident that the new design addresses those storm loads that we saw in 1979. The anchors were made much larger.
The new anchors are 3 stories tall and 46 feet. That's nearly 15 meters wide. They're basically vast buckets filled with rocks.
Each pontoon now has 3 anchors attached by cables, twice as thick as those on the wrecked bridge. In addition, the new maintenance hatches are now firmly watertight, so the maintenance decks are no longer an issue.
The solid concrete barriers were removed and they were replaced with cable rails. The new bridge should be able to survive those kinds of storms. That's what it was designed for.
The fix cost $150 million. And in 1982, the bridge reopened stronger than ever.
Once the Hood Canal Bridge was rebuilt, we all celebrated because we did a lot of traveling that way, and it was just a great relief to everybody.
Here it's clear that engineers learned their lessons really well. Anchors that couldn't drag, stronger cables, submarine-grade hatches, the list goes on. And makes you pretty confident that this bridge isn't going to be caught by surprise again.